Bundy. Bundy. Buck Bundy.
That's me.
I'm Thomas, your guide.
Where exactly am I?
You're where animals go when they die.
I'm in Oprah's refrigerator?
Let's rock.
Thanks, Dad.
Can I get a whoopin'?
No Man presents, live from the nudie bar, the Married with Children podcast.
Gunter. I mean, Bundy.
Chris here. Honestly, I'm kind of sensitive about this. This chicken just sat down on top of my bald head.
Oh, yeah? Like, what did you do?
I shot him in the face 6 times.
And this is Carolyn. I'd just like to say, Buongiorno, America.
Welcome back to the Married with Children podcast. This week we are reviewing Requiem for a Dead Briard, Season 10, Episode 3. Original air date, October 1st, 1995. After the Bundy family dog, Buck, dies, he goes to Animal Heaven, where his fate for eternity is to be dealt with by a feline judge. Al tries to cheer up the mourning Kelly by buying her another pet in the form of a parakeet until Peggy's mom eats it. Al then hires Father Guido Sarducci to conduct a seance to try to contact Buck in the afterlife. Written by Michael G. Moyet. Guest cast. Don Novello as Father Guido Sarducci. Kathleen Freeman as the voice of Peg's mom. Kevin Schoen as Felix D. Cat. Roger Rose as Tweety. Ben Stein as Thomas. Kim Weisskopf as the voice of Buck. Buck the dog as Buck the dog. And Lucky the dog as Lucky the dog.
Tonight, one member of the Bundy family won't survive the night.
This certainly sucks.
Married with Children, a brand new episode.
The title for this episode comes from Requiem for a Heavyweight, a teleplay written by Rod Sterling and produced for the live television show Playhouse 90 on October 11, 1956. 6 years later, it was adapted as a 1962 feature film starring Anthony Quinn, Jackie Gleason, and Mickey Rooney. The teleplay won a Peabody Award, the first given to an individual script in television, and helped establish Sterling's reputation. The broadcast was directed by Ralph Nelson and is generally considered one of the finest examples of live television drama in the United States, as well as being Sterling's personal favorite of his own work. Nelson and Sterling won Emmy Awards for their work.
Shout out to Jackie Gleason there, man. Brilliant actor.
Absolutely.
Anyone who's ever seen Smokey and the Bandit knows he's a brilliant actor, man.
And, The Honeymooners is probably probably my second favorite TV show of all time. So, Carolyn, welcome back.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us again. It's a real treat, and I know that our fan base in podcast land really loves to hear your comments. So thank you so much.
It's so nice to hear. Thanks.
Before we get into the episode, there's a couple of things we wanted to point out. So this is the second of three episodes in the Married with Children universe that began with the word Requiem. So the first one was Requiem for a Dead Barber. This is Requiem for a Dead Briard. And then there's a two-part episode, Requiem for a Chevyweight, parts 1 and 2. So a requiem or requiem mass, the word requiem is a Latin word. It's a mass for the dead. And the term in Latin is Missa pro defunctis or Missa defunctorum, which means Mass of the Dead. You know, offered for the repose of the soul or souls of one or more deceased persons. It is usually but not necessarily celebrated in the context of a funeral, and musical settings of the propers of the Requiem Mass are also called requiems, and the term has subsequently been applied to other musical compositions associated with death, dying, and mourning, whether they lack, even if they lack religious or liturgical relevance. So there's a very famous piece by Mozart, which is the Requiem in D minor, that he composed in Vienna in late 1791, but it was unfinished at his death on December 5th of the same year. And a completed version of this Requiem was done by Franz Xaver Süssmayr and was delivered to Count Franz von Welsgig, who commissioned the piece for a Requiem service to commemorate the anniversary of his wife's death on February 14th of that year.
That's interesting, that Requiem in D minor. I'd have to pull that up and listen to it, but I can almost guarantee I've probably either heard that or played it at some point, because I was in band for 4 years in middle school and junior high, and, you know, we played. Obviously, we played a lot of music, some old stuff, some new stuff, so be interesting to hear that. I bet it's pretty good.
It's excellent. It's excellent, and they're still writing them, actually. There were a few written for 9/11, after 9/11, especially my favorite is John Adams on the Transfiguration of Souls. So they're still around. And I have sung the Mozart Requiem myself, too, in a chorus in high school and college.
Yeah, no, it's a beautiful piece, absolutely.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
The episode begins with a very mournful rendition of Amazing Grace. Now, let me ask you, since, you know, we were all original sort of first-run fans, what do you remember the first time you saw this episode, what your thoughts were?
I do. I remember it like yesterday. It's funny you ask. So, you know, by this point in the series, I guess in 1996 is when this would have aired. By this point in the series, I was 12.
1995.
Okay. So by this point in the series, I was 11, so I was old enough to remember first run on everything. When we saw the preview of this, I don't know if we have the soundbite for it, but they advertised it as a member of the Bundy family dies. Well, we all thought it was going to be Al because Al, yeah, well, I mean, Al, I mean, of course we didn't want it to be Al, but Al's the oldest member of the family. He's probably the poorest in health. I mean, let's be honest, you know. So he has bad teeth. I mean, he has hemorrhoids. He has all types of problems, you know. So we thought it was going to be Al. And we spent all week, like, trying to figure out, are they going to kill off Al, you know, the star, the show? And I remember my dad saying, well, maybe it's going to be Jefferson, you know, even though Jefferson's not actually a member of the Bundy family. But my dad was like, well, Steve was in two episodes in season 9. Maybe Jefferson's going to die and Marcy's going to remarry Steve, you know. But we spent the whole week, like, trying to figure out, like, who are they going to kill off, you know. Sadly, I'm surprised none of us thought of Buck. I mean, it's kind of sad because Buck is a member of the family, you know. But none of us thought of him. And then the opening picture of Buck on the screen, me, my mom, and dad, all three simultaneously said, oh, my God, it's Buck. Like, we knew right away. Like, it hit us all at the same time, you know. So it's just like, I always remember that, thinking they're going to kill off Al. We were stunned. And then obviously in the opening scene, we learned it was Buck. It was kind of like, it's still sad we're losing Buck, but it was kind of a collective sigh of relief in a way. So, but that's my story. How about you, Carolyn?
Well, actually, ever since I saw Get the Dodge Out of Hell and how Buck was just kind of standing around and they were making jokes about how old he was, I kind of figured it would be Buck. But then again, I was a bit older than 11. So
yeah.
So yeah. Oh, and guys, do you think this is the only time fresh flowers have ever made an appearance in the Bundy house?
Yeah, I was going to make a comment about that. Yeah. Yeah. So, well, yeah, yeah. So from the great Annabelle, there was an Entertainment Weekly article on September 8th, 1995, so just about a month before this episode aired, where they noted that Buck the dog was retiring after 10 years as the sluggish pooch on Married with Children. Buck, 12 and a half, will retire from the series on October 1st. It's getting more difficult for him to distinguish hand signals from a distance, trainer Steve Ritt said of Buck, whose retirement plans include lying around a lot, going on hikes, getting acupuncture, and spending a lot of time with his girlfriend Frida. A new Bundy pet will be ushered in during the same episode. Now, at Team Australia and myself, we reviewed 25 years and What Do You Get on last season, and we had noted how his eyesight was getting bad. Also want to point out that Steve Ritt is on Facebook on the Married with Children unofficial page. So Annabelle is in contact with him, so maybe it'd be cool to hear from him.
I would love that. The work he did with Buck over those 10 years was amazing.
Yeah, that would be cool to hear, wouldn't it?
I remember when I saw that come up on the screen, I thought that the dog had actually died already. And I think that, you know, until we see, you know, Buck in doggy heaven, or if you can call it that, I was sad at first, you know, like I really felt sad. And I do remember Buck the dog dying, you know, in real life, which was on May 28th, 1996. And this was literally the week that I was graduating high school. I remember it very distinctly. I remember it on the news. It made, you know, pretty much national news that Buck the dog died. So that was about 9 months after this episode aired.
That's sad. That's sad when you think about it. It's like, darn, he didn't even get to enjoy a year's worth of retirement, you know?
I think, you know, the tribute that they have with Amazing Grace is beautiful. Yeah. And we've heard Amazing Grace as well on Married with Children in the past.
Yes, but I didn't shoot the deputy.
That's right. I think probably, to me, like one of the most underrated episodes of season one.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and you know, actually, it was also Mourning a Dog.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just realized that, yes. Yes, well, it's a lovely song, and it's what they love about it the most is that it's public domain.
Yeah.
So,
yep.
But I thought it was a great start to the episode. I think it set the mood. I think it set the mood really well.
Everyone is grieving, and we have Al and Peggy and Bud and Kelly and Jefferson and Marcy all in that living room, and Al especially seems to be taking it hard.
Funeral, Peggy. I'm sure Buck would have been proud.
I know. I just can't believe he's gone. You know, it seems like only yesterday he was chewing up the furniture and peeing on the floor.
That was yesterday.
Well, your father seems to be taking it especially hard. Poor guy.
$1,200 for a funeral! They buried King Tut for less. And he got to take his wives with him.
I cannot believe how cheap you are, Al. I mean, Buck was more than family. He was someone we loved.
That may well be, Peg. But at $1,200 for a 70-pound dog, do you realize how expensive your mom's going to be? I'd say bury her at sea, but then we'd have one less sea.
All right, Al, you can say what you want about Mom.
Okay, she's a great big pilot.
But I want you to be careful what you say about Buck around Kelly. She was closer to him than any of us, and she's going to need some extra love and attention.
It's because it's $1,200 for a funeral.
Right.
I wonder if a real person's funeral would have cost that much in the Bundy world.
I don't know. Like I'm trying to figure out, like, do people, maybe this is a dumb question on my part, but I'll ask anyways. Do people actually do full blown funerals for dogs? Like, I remember as a kid, you know, like, I don't know if this is a Southern thing or if people do this all over the country, but whenever our pets passed away, we would always, you know, wrap them in a blanket and bury them in our backyard.
Up here in New York too. Yes. Yes.
Okay,
our dog Bella, you know, when she was put to sleep, we got the ashes back and we buried them in the backyard under one of our favorite trees.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, we didn't have an actual funeral, but
it's not a Northeastern thing either, you know, but however, we do have pet cemeteries. That's not particularly scary one. That's Stephen King pet cemeteries.
Yeah. Yeah.
We do have pet cemeteries. So some people do that, but an actual funeral ceremony, no. It is nice. You can buy a card saying sorry about your pet, you know, and I've done that a few times. You know, someone had a cat for like 17 years or something, like some of my friends, then I send that. Yeah. But no, I think this is a little TV exaggeration going.
Right. Well, what I'm thinking is like if it's a, you know, like a real life famous animal, like I'm trying to think, like, let's say like when Secretariat died, you know, Secretariat the horse. I can imagine they might have actually had a funeral for Secretariat. You know what I mean? But like a regular, you know, family that just owns a cat or a dog, I can't imagine, you know, spending a large amount of money.
At the end of the day, it's like how much money do you have to spend, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, totally. Totally.
Right.
I mean, if you got $50, it's a $50 funeral. If it's $1,200, it's a $1,200 funeral, right?
That seems to be the way the Bundys do everything, though. I mean, like,
that's right.
If they, you know, if the bank deposits money in their account by mistake, they go crazy. Or, you know, if Bud's check gets deposited in their account by mistake, they go crazy. If the bank gives Buck a credit card, they go crazy and spend everything. I mean, that's just how the Bundys do.
Mm-hmm. You know, if I wasn't so lazy, I would have gone through this episode again and added up how much money came out of Al's pocket. Because it was a lot.
Yeah, I mean, it was at least close to $3,000, I think, when you tally it up, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And by the way, where does Al – how the hell does Al have $3,000 to spend on a funeral?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, we've done the math on his income before. He's slightly above minimum wage. I mean, I guess he's gotten a couple of raises at this point, so he's at least a little above minimum wage. But where the heck does he have $3,000 to spend on a funeral for a dog, you know?
We have no idea.
So we find out that the person who is the most upset of all is Kelly.
Sorry I'm late, but I stopped over at Hallmark to see if I could get a really nice thanks for leaving me at the pet cemetery card. Naturally, they were all sold out, so I'm going to make up my own. What rhymes with may you all heave and gag on your own chunks?
Well, let's see. There's punks, drunks... Punks.
Now, let me tell you, when Kelly makes her entrance, it's like I remember I was mourning Buck, but then I'm like sort of like my tongue rolled out of my mouth when I saw her in that black dress.
You know, actually, guys, I was going to talk about that. It's the only time. Yeah, that black dress was nice. I mean, it was fairly modest for Kelly, but it was a nice dress and it looked great on her as everything does. But did you notice that no one in the audience catcalled her? There was no woo or anything. Maybe it was the occasion, or maybe the director just said, okay, maybe they cut it out, or they just said, you know, no, we just showed like the dog died. We don't do that.
Yeah.
But what do you think?
I think she just was stunning. I mean, like, I'll tell you, like, I mean, you know, we've seen Kelly through the years, but I mean, you know, like looking at this, you know, when I was rewatching the episode for this podcast, I was like, whoa, like, I mean, wow. Like, I mean, she was breathtaking.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And I do want to point out recently, Christina Applegate came out and said that she has multiple sclerosis. So,
yeah.
You know, we are, I mean, I guess, I don't know if she ever will listen to our podcast, but we do want to send out our love and support.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's heartbreaking news. You know, we're all, you know, love and adore Christina Applegate. She's an amazing performer, you know, on multiple shows and movies. She's an incredible human being, you know, by every respect. So we wish her well. Hopefully she's back to 100% or as close to 100% as possible very, very soon.
Yes, I've been lucky enough to see her. Of course, I watch her shows on television whenever I can. I've also seen her on stage. And I'm sorry she's had to deal with so many health issues in her life, because she comes across as so vibrant and so in control of her body, and she's a wonderful dancer, and I hope she keeps dancing. Hope she keeps dancing for another 50 years.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we definitely wish her well.
Yes.
So there's one topic I wanted to talk about. Now, if we're going to continuity. In season one and two, it was very clear that Buck was Bud's dog.
Yes. Yeah, I had that, yes. But Buck can do it, yeah.
That's right. So, you know, we've now gotten to season 10. It's as if the ownership has changed.
I do have to say, I was a little disappointed with Bud in this episode. You see, he was like a little callous. You know, yeah. Usually he's the one that has like some hidden feelings, like some halfway recognizable human feelings.
Yeah.
And even if he hides it. And he was paired up with Jefferson in this episode. And of course, Jefferson is always, you know, he's not evil. He's just kind of careless.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And they were paired up and making, you know, cracking a lot of jokes at Buck's expense and stuff, which, you know, some of which were very funny, but I was a little upset with Bud.
Yeah. Now, I mean, if you remember, Bud was the one who okayed for Buck to get neutered. So maybe Buck's allegiance, you know, shifted over to Kelly. You know,
good idea. That would make sense.
Yeah. You know, Chris, I was going to say, like, if Alex were doing this podcast, I'm sort of thinking in his head, like, that's probably how he would have put two and two together.
Yeah. Well, you know what I was thinking? You know, we were talking about the ownership of Buck. Correct me if I'm wrong, but didn't at a certain point it was almost as if Buck was Al's dog, because, you know, he had the episode, well, the computer episode where he was trying to teach, if my memory serves me correct, wasn't Al trying to teach Buck how to fetch his slippers in that episode? Or if I'm not combining two there, but I think at the end, you know, Al smashes the computer and he goes over there with the hammer and says, okay, now get my slippers. And Buck does it, you know. And then there's the episode where Buck the Stud, I forget what the title of it is, but, you know, Al puts Buck down in the basement with his Playboys and he shreds them and everything, you know, because he wants that, I think it was a check for $10,000, but he ends up getting a bill for $100,000. but, I mean, at that point, I think it was fair to say that Buck was Al's dog, wouldn't you say? I mean... At least it seemed like it to me.
Yeah, no, I mean, you're definitely right. I mean, there is shifting ownership. So it's sort of like, you know, I guess Kelly, the character of Kelly would have been more believable for having the grief. Like, you know, Bud as a character is not going to be grieving. Al is not going to be grieving either, except for, you know, I guess however much he's out.
The $1,200, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Peg doesn't care. So I think it naturally fell on the character of Kelly to be the person to mourn the dog.
Okay, and of course, Christina did a great job, I thought.
Absolutely.
I thought she was really convincing in Kelly's grief. And of course, she was, you know, she was like sobbing like she was in an opera, but that was part of the point, because when Kelly feels something, she feels it so deeply that she has no control. And I think that really came across.
You know, what I was going to say is that as far as the ownership shifting of the dog, if you sort of think about it, that kind of happens in a family. You know, let's say you're your teenager gets a dog when it's a puppy. The teenager might take care of the dog, and then the teen goes off to college. Well, the college student's probably not going to bring a dog with them, so the parents have to take care of him. Or maybe a younger brother or sister takes care of him until that kid goes off to college, and that by that point, the parents are taking care of him, you know?
That's true, yeah.
the ownership does kind of shift like that if you think about it.
So how'd you get home, Kel?
Oh, I got a ride from Igor, the guy who drives the doggy hearse. You know, the one that Dad was too cheap to spend the extra $40 on.
There's nothing wrong with the trunk of the Dodge. Buck always liked going for a nice ride in the car, and he looked so peaceful, his head propped up on the spare tire.
Now, Kelly talks about riding in the doggy hearse with a guy named Igor. Now, I'm going to do a callback to Season 3, Episode 9, the first episode that had the title Requiem, which is Requiem for a Dead Barber, where Kelly talks about cruising around the cemetery with Boris.
Well, now that Tony's worm food, I can get out of these funeral clothes. Oh, Dad, you know how I've been bothering you about a sports car? Well, forget it. I want a hearse. I was just cruising around the cemetery with Boris, the driver. Oh, God, was it cool. And on Friday night, he's taking me out and promised to have a real dead body in it. But Mom said it's wrong to use a guy for his hearse, so can I have one of my own, please?
Well, Al, she has been doing better in school.
Why am I thinking they buried the wrong guy?
That's funny.
That's kind of advice my mother never had to give me. and one last thing, guys, before we leave this beginning here. When Bud gets home, he goes to the refrigerator, he gets out a sandwich and a soda, and he's eating it through half the scene. Where the hell did he get those?
I noticed that. I was like, wait a second, how does the Bundy fridge have food in it? Like, what's going on here? What in the world?
Unless the food came, I guess, as part of the cemetery. Like, sometimes I've heard, like, in some people, like, they'll have, like, some kind of, like, a wake where there'll be food.
Yeah. Oh, that makes sense. You know. Mm-hmm.
Not sort of in my tradition. I mean, there's food in other places, but not, like, it's part of the wake.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
So Kelly says that she thinks she's feeling better, and then she breaks down.
So how are you feeling, Kelly?
Oh, I'm better, I guess. I think I'm over Buck's death now, and I'm ready to get on with my life.
Atta girl, Pumpkin. I admire your courage. Now, help me clean up the yard, and we'll burn Buck's old toys.
To think, I could have had any man on the football team.
Peg, you had them all. Pumpkin, now you know that I love Buck more than I love anyone in this room. Way, way more than some. But, sweetheart, let's not dwell on sad things.
Daddy, what do you think Buck's doing right now?
Well, yeah, I don't know, sweetheart. He should still be dead, shouldn't he?
Oh, Buck. Buck, wherefore art thou, Buckio? Where?
Now, Al and Peg have some great banter. It's like, and to think I could have had any man on the football team. Peg, you've had them all.
That's right. Yeah.
They retired her number, remember? We learned that in an earlier episode.
Yeah, that was the Sam Kinison episode.
Oh, yeah, sure was.
That's right. Yeah, and Al's trying to be... He's trying to be a halfway decent dad. You know, he's calling Kelly Pumpkin and he's holding up while he's crying. But of course, he can't resist the chance to slip in a promiscuity joke right in the middle of it all because he's out.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So now, like, you know, Kelly's wondering, like, what Buck might be doing right now. And Al's like, well, I don't know. Well, he should still be dead. Again, very heartless of Al. No tact. And Kelly does this line where she's actually quoting Romeo and Juliet.
Mm-hmm.
So, oh, Buck, Buck, wherefore art thou, Bucky-o? Yep. So now we cut to Buck up in heaven.
I'll be damned. I really can see my house from here.
I mean, I remember seeing this the first time and I breathed a sigh of relief. It's like, oh, Buck the dog is still alive.
Yes.
Right. And, you know, I will say at this point, I was trying to think to myself, it's like, well, you know, how is Buck going to be alive again, right? Yeah. It's like, I thought to myself, I was like, oh, you know, Buck, he'll be back next week. And maybe this is some kind of maybe dream sequence or not. As soon as I hear this particular voice, I think, like, I started cheering because just as soon as you hear it, you know exactly what it is.
Bundy, Bundy, Buck, Bundy.
That's me.
I'm Thomas, your guide.
Where exactly am I?
You're where animals go when they die.
I'm in Oprah's refrigerator?
No, Buck, you're in the animal afterlife.
Well, then, what are you doing here?
Computer error. I was the mascot for a baseball team, the Cleveland Chickens. I had this really great bit where I'd find some guy bald as an egg and sit on his head. A scream, I tell you, until one day I met a bald guy who was a tad sensitive about it.
Oh, what'd he do?
Shot me in the face 6 times.
Yep, he has one of the most recognizable voices around, that's for sure.
Yeah, and was this along a period where the show Win Ben Stein's Money was on TV?
I don't think so, no.
I feel like this was a little before Ben Stein's Money, I feel like. This would have been around the time that those Clear Eyes commercials were on. Remember those?
Observe dry eyes, red eyes, symptoms for which science created Clear Eyes. Unlike the other leading eye drop, Clear Eyes removes redness and as an ingredient to moisturize. The difference is clear. Clear Eyes.
Oh, yes, that's like, right.
Clear Eyes is awesome. Remember that? So, Ben Stein is an American writer, lawyer, actor, comedian, and commentator on political and economic issues. He began his career as a speechwriter for U.S. Presidents Richard Nixon and Gerald Ford, before entering the entertainment field as an actor, comedian, and game show host. He is best known on screen as the economics teacher in Ferris Bueller's Day Off, as the host of Win Ben Stein's Money, and as Dr. Arthur Newman in The Mask and Son of the Mask. Stein co-wrote and starred in the 2008 documentary Expelled, which portrays intelligent design creationism as a scientifically valid alternative to Darwin evolution, and alleges a scientific conspiracy against those promoting intelligent design in laboratories and classrooms. Stein is the son of economist and writer Herbert Stein, who worked at the White House under President Nixon. As a character actor, he is well known for his droning, monotonous delivery. In comedy, he is known for his deadpan delivery.
And Married with Children put him in a chicken suit.
Yeah. That's pretty
perfect.
Funny.
Perfect. Yes.
So, I mean, like, what do you think his best portrayal is, Carolyn? Would you say from Ferris Bueller's Day Off, I think, is most famous?
I think so, yes. Yes. And it was so iconic. And he managed to convey exactly what Ferris was avoiding by skipping school, how he wasn't missing anything. He made the whole school look like a really pointless waste of time. So, yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, Buck asks, where he is. And, Ben says that you're where animals go to die. So he says, I'm in Oprah's refrigerator.
Oprah joke and a fat joke. That's good writing. Two for one. Yep.
Yeah. And, you know, and I think one of the great things, too, is, you know, he says, well, then what are you doing here? And he says, computer error. Yeah, you know, and if you think about it now, this is 1995. You know, we've really entered the age of, you know, computerization, you know, the early days, you know, compared to today. But, you know, in 1987, when the series started, you know, something like computer error, like, wouldn't have been like, as maybe in vogue in terms of like a joke that people would get or be joking about. So, I mean, it's really like a sign of the times.
Yeah, it is. You know, it's funny you were talking about that because I was watching an old episode of, I guess I'm dating myself a little bit, but Mighty Morphin Power Rangers the other day, which was one of my favorite shows as a kid. And there was a scene where in this particular episode, they fight a computer monster. And in the opening scene, one of the Power Rangers is on the computer and he's surfing the internet. And the way he explains it to the audience, like, it's clear that the internet era is like it's just crazy. Like, he explains 60 seconds about how the internet works. It's like, yeah, you just type in right here. You type the website that you want to go to, and then you can pull up information, and you can surf the net, and you can do this and that and this and that. You know, it's now like if they showed that in a television show in 2021, you would just see someone looking at a computer screen, and you'd assume that they're surfing the net. Like, they wouldn't take 60 seconds out of the actual show to explain that, you know? It's amazing, like, when you think about how much things have changed in the last 25, 26, 27 years.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
And I gotta love how, like, you know, they also have to throw in a bald joke. So, you know, again, for Dan Chase and the rest of the bad chapter of No Man, of which, you know, Chris and myself and Matt Thompson and Stephen Scott are members of, took personal offense on that one.
That's right.
What's that?
Gabriel's beeper. That means it's time for the judge to determine your fate. If you've been good, you'll be reincarnated as the animal of your choice.
Well, in that case, I'd like to come back as an eagle, soaring proud and free.
How patriotic. But if you do come back as an eagle, do yourself a favor.
What's that?
Don't land on any bald guys with guns.
Here's another joke, and it's, again, a little bit of a time capsule. So Ben Stein talks about having Gabriel's beeper.
Right, yes.
And this, I'm going to say, these are like the last days of the beeper. Like 1995 to 1997 is like sort of when they started disappearing and were replaced by cell phones.
Yeah, I sort of like, I guess, you know, that was kind of a transitional period for me from junior high to high school. I remember being in junior high in 97, 98, 99, that time period. And I remember thinking, man, I can't wait till I get to high school so I can have a pager. And by the time I got to high school, you know, right before the turn of the millennium, pagers were out and cell phones were in. Like, everybody started getting phones, you know. It's like it happened overnight. It's weird growing up in that era, you know.
Yeah. So, Carolyn, do you have any beeper stories?
No, sorry, never had one.
No?
Nope. I just wasn't that important, I don't think.
Okay. I didn't have a beeper either. I remember, though, when I was in the fifth grade, which was well before this, you know, and I'm going to say it was around 1988, one of my friends had two beepers and a cell phone. So I imagine like a cell phone from 1988, and he was probably maybe 5 feet tall. His name was Augie, right?
Oh, wow.
So this, you know, little Catholic grammar school in Queens, like he shows up with like these two beepers and a cell phone, like on his belt. And like as he's walking, he's like hiking up his pants, like because the weight of these things were like pretty much like making his pants drop to the ground. You know, I think it was either the principal or the assistant principal, who was a nun. Like she calls out to him, is like, hey, Augie, like, what are you, a drug dealer? And he responds like, no, sister, I'm a businessman.
I was thinking, I mean, was this cell phone, was it like a brick or something, like the size of a brick?
Oh, absolutely.
Because I've seen those old phones from the 80s. They're like literally the size of a brick.
I think the three of those items combined weighed as much as he did.
That's right. Oh, boy.
And probably, I mean, I'm trying to figure out what you said 1988. I mean, a cell phone and two beepers, that probably would have been like, I mean, I'm assuming he was like a rich kid, right? Because, I mean, a cell phone and two beepers would have been expensive as hell in 1988, wouldn't it?
Well, he was a businessman. As he said.
I mean, that technology then would have been expensive, you know.
He used to work at a pizzeria. you know, unfortunately, he died. He died in a car accident in 1999.
Oh, man. Sorry to hear
so,
that.
Yeah, but, you know, one of my remembrances is my friend Augie. Augustino is his real name, right?
Yep.
So Ben Stein, or what's the name? Thomas, right, is the name of the character. Thomas says that, I know the character, you know, we have to say the character, but it's like, you got to say it's Ben Stein. I mean, everybody should know it's Ben Stein. So, you know, so he says that, you know, if Buck has been good, you know, he'll be able to be reincarnated as the animal of his choice. And Buck decides to go patriotic and wishes that he were an eagle.
What animal would you guys, if you guys could be reincarnated as an animal, what animal would you guys choose?
You know, I've actually thought about this before. I can't decide if I want to be a dog, like a domestic dog, or a dolphin. You know,
Those are two good ones.
Yeah, well, I mean, the dolphin has freedom to like explore the oceans and stuff. It can go wherever it wants, you know. But a dog just gets like so much love and attention and everything. Just as long as they avoid certain behaviors, like barking at all the deer.
Yeah. The only problem with being a dog would be it's just luck of the draw who what owner you get. I mean, if you get a great owner, then you're gonna have a great life. If you get a lousy owner, they might put you outside on a chain. You know what I mean? Like, so it just depends on which owner you get, I guess.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Yeah, I probably would have to run away a few times to find the right owner.
But right. Yeah.
How about you?
I think I might go with Buck's answer. The bald eagle, I mean, you get to fly, and you're also, if I'm not mistaken, I think bald eagles are a protected class, right? Like, you're not allowed to do anything to them because they're, at one point, I think they were an endangered species, but I think they've recovered. But they're also, since they're our national bird, I don't think you're allowed to, like, hunt them or hurt them or do anything to them, right?
Chris, you already got the bald part down, so it's just a matter of the eagle. Right?
I'm already halfway there. If I start, if I learn how to fly, people might think I'm an eagle.
That's right. That's right.
I was in a zoo in Providence, Rhode Island this summer, and there were, like, I think three bald eagles, like, on a perch. I thought it was great. Like, I took a picture of it. I think I posted it on our page, and I was like, well, it's a bad chapter meeting, you know, in Providence. I don't know. I guess for myself, when it comes to, like, I never really thought about it, Chris, but I think I would want to be something that nobody wants to eat. I mean, that's the kind of animal I think I'd want to be.
Right.
You know, I'll tell you, Italians, you know, if you just put a little bit of tomato sauce, garlic, and cheese on it, you know, we'll eat anything.
You know, I would say, well, my instinct before thinking about a bald eagle was to say an alligator or a crocodile because they're so tough. Ooh. You know what I mean? I mean,
yeah.
Not many animals will mess with a gator or a croc. The only problem is humans do eat gator and croc, so you have that to deal with. But as far as in the wild, there's not many animals that will mess with a croc or a gator.
Now, I've eaten alligator in Brooklyn, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Cajun place, I remember, probably maybe 15, 20 years ago. It was delicious. It tasted like chicken.
I knew you were going to say that. Yeah, we had in Boston's Back Bay, there used to be a place called the Rattlesnake Bar that we used to go to after classes sometimes. And most of the time we actually ate, like, you know, chicken and burgers and stuff like that. But they had a few exotic things. You know, they had ostrich once, they had buffalo before that was, like, widely popular, things like that. As far as I know, they did not have rattlesnake, but, you know, they knew where they could get some. So, you know who would eat anything? Peg's mom, yeah. As you find out. As we soon find out, she would have no qualms.
So, Pumpkin, just know that Buck is in a happier place now. Has to be. He's not here. As long as you carry him in your heart, a part of him will always be with you.
That was beautiful, Daddy. I feel a lot better now. Thanks.
No problem, sweetheart. Okay. Bud, help me chop up the doghouse for firewood.
No!
Now!
Daddy, we are not going to get rid of anything that was Buck's. He will always be a part of this family. Always.
Al, I think you're going to have to get a replacement.
Are you serious? Where am I going to get another daughter?
I think she meant a replacement for Buck.
What we find out is that Al wants to be really keen on getting rid of everything as quickly as possible, which upsets Kelly. You know, and then there's, like, this joke. It's like, you know, it's like, you know, he's like, well, I think you're going to have to get a replacement. It's like, where am I going to get another daughter? You know?
Well, you know, guys, I think it's a variation on the old joke. You know, my wife went away with my dog, and boy, do I miss him.
I always find it funny how all of the Bundys have moments of, like, just pure stupidity, and then they have moments of high intelligence almost. You know what I mean? Like, Peg had the episode where she was selling the what was it, the beauty products or whatever, and she was buying all of her own stuff. She was leading the contest because she was buying all of her own stuff. And Al was the only one smart enough to tell her, you know. And then, you know, Al has his episodes where he's extremely dumb. Well, Kelly's dumb pretty much every episode, but they all have these moments where they're just extremely dumb.
Yeah. Because, I mean, it looks like Al is trying to console Kelly, but then he goes and says, like, the worst possible thing you can say to someone who's grieving.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, he's like, I'm gonna go burn all of Buck's toys, you know, in the backyard. Or let's go bury his stuff in the backyard. Or let's use his stuff as firewood, like, you know.
Exactly. Yeah. So that means there must be a fireplace and that wall we can't see behind the TV.
Yeah, I was going to say that. Yeah, Carolyn, I was going to say that. Like, where do the Bundys have a fireplace? Unless maybe like they have like some kind of trash bin fire outside, right?
Oh, that would make sense. Yeah, yeah, I'm sure they're just the kind that would illegally burn trash.
Yep, definitely.
Yep.
I can't afford a pet since Peg's mom, aka Free Willy, beats herself upstairs.
I can roll over if I want to.
We hear Peg's mom upstairs. In the season opener, the podcast went through, you know, Kathleen Freeman, you know, because she's the new character who appears for season 10. And she is the 7 of season 10.
Yeah, only better, I think. Only much better. Significantly better.
And you know, and I'm going to point out heard but not seen. And you know something, Carolyn? I'm actually going to quote you on this one.
Okay.
You know, you said in a prior episode, I think, you know, Levin and Moyer, like there's certain things that, you know, your imagination will do a better job than anything that they can actually show us on screen.
Yep.
So, you know, kudos to them, because we can only imagine what she looks like. And, you know, I think I've pointed out in the past, there's a Married with Children comic book series from the 90s, and there are at least 2 depictions of Peg's mom in them. So,
yes.
You know, so she looks like a very fat version of Peg.
Yeah, she looks like a giant Peg, exactly. Now, I do have to say, I know what Kathleen Freeman looks like, because I had the pleasure of seeing her on stage in her Tony-nominated turn in The Full Monty in 2000.
I love her performance in The Blues Brothers. She plays the penguin.
Yes, yes.
Oh, that's funny. I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
I love her voice in it. I think they did a great job casting her as the voice of Peg's mom. I mean, she sounds, you know, old and grouchy, and you know what I mean? Just, like, I think they did a great job casting her.
But still she has like a strength to her, though. You don't want to mess with her.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, like, I'll tell you, like in The Blues Brothers, she plays that Catholic nun, you know, to a T.
Yes. Yeah. And on The Full Monty, she was, you know, she was much, much warmer and nicer and everything, but still very tough. And absolutely delightful.
So Al refers to his mother-in-law as Free Willy. So Free Willy is a 1993 American family drama film directed by Simon Windsor and produced by Lauren Shuler Donner and Jenny Lou Tagund, written by Keith A. Walker and Corey Bleckman, from a story by Walker and distributed by Warner Brothers under their Family Entertainment imprint. So it was shot between May and August of 1992 and released in July 16th of 1993, and received positive attention from critics and was a commercial success, grossing $153.6 million from a $20 million budget. It grew into a small franchise, including a television series, 2 sequels, and a direct-to-video reboot.
Yeah, I enjoyed that movie. I remember it had Michael Jackson singing at the end whenever Willie, if you've seen it, of course, Willie jumps over the rocks and goes off to freedom, and I believe it was Michael Jackson singing there at the end.
Wow, well, I didn't know to stop it. I was into whales, so I did like the movie too.
Yeah, good ending.
Mm-hmm.
So Jefferson pipes in.
Hey, I've got a great idea. I have a friend who owns a pet store. Well, actually, he's a crooked customs agent who smuggles in endangered species and some really great imported porn. I mean, corn.
Wait a second, how much is this porn, what's this pet gonna cost?
Gee, I don't know, Al. What's the spending limit on Kelly's peace of mind?
$11.
No, you don't, Al Bundy. You're not gonna Scrooge your way out of this one. Kelly is your only daughter.
This is my only $11 pet. All right, I promise to get her a pet that she'll love.
So Jefferson says he's got a crooked customs agent who smuggles in endangered species and some great imported porn.
I love that. Yeah. I love that. Yeah. Saliza Jefferson is my favorite Jefferson.
Yeah. That seems to pique Al's interest.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say, did you notice how Al and Bud both looked up? Did you notice how Bud was looking? the look on Bud's face when Jefferson said that?
So the spending limit on Kelly's peace of mind is $11. So, you know, so he spent $1,200. He has $11. And later on, it's like the bird costs $1,000. Where the hell does this come from? I assume Al has no credit.
Yeah. Right? That's a safe statement. Remember Al's famous line? He said, if a bank is dumb enough to give me credit, let's charge it up and let the honest people pay for it.
That's right. We have a former teller with us. So,
yeah.
Well, guys, like they say, it's simple Bundynomics. We just can't wrap our heads around it.
Right.
So Peggy says that Al isn't going to Scrooge her way out of this. So it makes a reference to A Christmas Carol.
So, Kelly, tell me which one of these cool pets is going to be the new buck.
Oh, forget it, Daddy. I can't take a goldfish on a walk. I can't scratch a moth behind its ears. And I can't teach an ant farm to pee in Bud's shoes.
So we're now shown three options for pets. A goldfish, a moth, and an ant farm. And Kelly is not impressed. So the Darcys bring in a bird.
Kelly, have we got the pet for you?
What is it this time? A bird!
Takes one to buy one.
But this isn't just any bird, Kel. This is a genuine Venezuelan emerald-crested cockatoo. He does great celebrity impressions.
And he knows over 150 different words.
That's got your father beat right there.
Yeah, but he's not Buck. Can he roll over and play dead?
Buck couldn't do that.
Till now.
Look, Kelly, I know he's not Buck, but you really should give him a chance.
Yeah, look, we got him on approval, so if you don't want him after a week, he goes back. Look.
Kelly Pretty. Kelly Pretty.
Well, he is awfully cute. And smart.
He's a cute little guy. How much?
$1,000.
Well, I'll give him a try. I just hope it's okay with Buck.
And Al has a great line there. It takes one to buy one.
Yes.
So it's a genuine Venezuelan emerald-crested cockatoo. And it does great celebrity impressions and knows over 150 words.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, like, so do you guys know anything about, like, you know, these types of birds?
Well, I know enough to know that that was actually a self-crested cockatoo. So, yeah, self-crested cockatoos, they're, I don't know about the vocalization. I know they can vocalize a bit. They're not like parrots, but I think what you see them on the web nowadays mostly is dancing. They're very good at catching rhythms and dancing along with people.
Interesting. You know, I'm looking them up on Wikipedia, and it seems that they are indigenous to the Australasia area. So maybe our friends at Team Australia can pipe in the comments on this one.
Yep. Yeah, well, they're not from Venezuela, but it would not surprise me if they bought a bird thinking it was, you know, emerald-crested cockatoo, and it's clearly yellow-crested.
Yeah, so Al faints when he finds out that it's $1,000.
Yep.
All right, so we have $1,000, $11, $1,200 for a funeral. So what are we at, $22.11?
$22.11, yeah.
So far,
$22.11,
right.
Yeah.
So... Oh, well, let's keep going. So now we cut back to heaven, and Buck is excited that he thinks he's going to be an eagle. But there is trouble in heaven.
I'm going to be an eagle. I'm going to be an eagle.
If the judge decides that you've been good.
Oh, he will. Everybody loves me.
All rise for the Honorable Judge Felix D. Cat.
Well, I just hope I get a defense lawyer who can stand up to a cat.
Buck Bundy? Ira Moskowitz, I'm your court-appointed attorney.
Houston, we have a problem.
Felix the Cat is a funny animal cartoon character created in the silent film era. The anthropomorphic black cat with its black body, wide eyes, and giant grin, coupled with the surrealism of the situations in which his cartoons placed him, combined to make Felix one of the most recognized cartoon characters in film history. Felix was the first character from animation to attain a level of popularity sufficient to draw movie audiences.
My dad actually has some old black and white movies. Old black and white silent cartoons of Felix. So he was also in the Betty Boop era, and it was generally like the the clever, you know, the clever peasant stereotype, the one who everyone ignores, and then he goes out and does great things and gets his way all the time.
We find out that Buck is being represented and defended by his court-appointed attorney Ira Moskowitz. So we have a Jewish mouse lawyer, I guess, bunch of stereotypes
although I think he was in real life, I think he was a rat, but not that it mattered much, but yeah.
I thought it was a squirrel. I mean, the thing is that when I looked at him, but he's, I guess, some kind of, I don't know if it's a like groundhog or something, but he looked to me more like a squirrel. But I mean, if he's calling himself Moskowitz, I'm going to assume he's a mouse or a rat, right?
I think so, yeah. I mean, I saw a rat, but the audience can decide. Take a look at the episode and decide what kind of creature he was. Definitely a rodent.
So one line that Buck says here that's pretty funny is, Houston, we have a problem.
Yep.
That's one of the most, one of the biggest, like, what's the word I'm looking for? Like overused phrases ever here in Texas. Like, I mean, it gets used for everything. Like, the Rockets have a bad game. Houston, we have a problem. The Astros have a bad game. Houston, we have a problem. Our power grid collapses. Houston, we have a problem. I mean, it's like it's used for everything. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I've heard that line so many times. Just this week.
Yep. Well, it's a great line, but I think like Elementary, My Dear Watson, I think it's a slight misquote.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're absolutely right, Carolyn. Absolutely right. Mm-hmm. It's not the original quote.
Mm-hmm.
The most famous thing that's nobody ever said, right?
Yeah.
So that comes from the Apollo 13 movie from 1995, directed by Ron Howard and starring Tom Hanks, Kevin Bacon, Bill Paxton, Gary Sinise, and Ed Harris. The screenplay by William Broyles Jr. and Al Reinhart dramatizes the aborted 1970 Apollo 13 lunar mission and is an adaptation of the book Lost Moon, The Perilous Voyage of Apollo 13 by astronaut Jim Lovell and Jeffrey Kluger. I mean, and that was really big in 1995. I mean, that summer, I mean, that was probably, you know, the biggest. I mean, I think with Forrest Gump a few years earlier and Apollo 13, that pretty much cemented Tom Hanks as probably the greatest American actor since probably Jimmy Stewart, I would say.
Oh yeah. It was huge, and it was a time, and it kind of fit in with the you know, people were feeling a little down in America sometimes, so it was like one of those things, like America felt like really uplifted just by watching it.
Yeah, that's a great cast too. Tom Hanks, Kevin Bacon, Ed Harris. It's a really good cast. Written by Ron Howard, or directed by Ron Howard, excuse me.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And we've had many members of his family on Married with Children.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, his mother plays the elderly lady in a handful of episodes.
Yep, and his brother was his brother was also in the and Bingo was her game-o.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow.
I hope Tweety likes the new gifts we got him.
Yeah, it'll be just like Christmas.
Yeah, except Dad's sober and somebody's getting presents.
I guess it's true what they say. Nothing brings a family together like a new pet.
It's funny, like, they walk in, and it's like, I hope Tweety likes the gifts we got him. And he says, it'd just be like Christmas, except Dad's sober and somebody's getting presents.
That's
hey,
great.
Hey, by the way, have you guys noticed Al's wardrobe has changed again? I know Alex pointed this out. You know, of course, seasons one through, I guess, about seven-ish, Al pretty much just had one or two outfits that he would wear. I mean, he would wear the brown pants and that bluish shirt, that light blue shirt. And then he went through that stretch where he would wear that god-awful purple shirt that we all hate. Well, now he's wearing, like, black khakis. You notice that? Or I guess that was part of his suit. I guess he took his suit jacket off. But it just looks funny because he's wearing black pants and he's wearing a white and blue striped shirt.
You're right. He's a little dressed up. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I did notice when he had the bag on his shoulder, it was a little incongruous. It was over his dress shirt.
Yeah.
I mean, he's got he's carrying a 100-pound bag of cockatoo feed, right?
Yeah.
And I don't know if you noticed this, but Peg and the others, they're carrying this bag called Petropolis.
Yes.
Petropolitan. Sorry.
I don't think that's a real store. I haven't heard of it.
I did Google it. I did find that there are places called Petropolitan, but it's not. I think they might have been done independently from Married with Children.
Yeah.
Almost like Metropolitan or Petropolitan. So, you know, not a bad way of doing it.
Busted Tweety's bird food.
It's no problem. I was on my way back to town to have a hernia operation anyway. Can I get anybody else 100 pounds anything?
Jujubes!
Well, there's a couple of lines from this episode that I like to use, and one of them is Al's line here. Can I get anybody else 100 pounds of anything?
Yeah, and it's jujubes. So, you know what jujubes are?
I had never heard of that. I had never heard of that before this.
It's an old-fashioned candy. It was still sold when I was a kid. They're kind of like little gelatin bun-shaped things in different flavors. They're kind of like Mike and Ike's and those guys.
Yeah, I'm not like I guess like I'm not a big fan of like soft candy, like the chewy kind. So I think I probably tried them, but I wasn't really a fan of them.
I'm gonna give Tweety his cuddle bone. Yeah.
Hey, where'd he go?
Somebody left the cage open. He must have flown upstairs.
Upstairs?
Oh, no.
Oh, my God. A feather.
Gee, I was wondering why Mom sent out for white wine.
What do you mean you thought it was a chicken?
Tweety.
Well, I've got some good news and got some bad news. Good news is Tweety knew over 150 words.
Well, what's the bad news, Dad?
Bad news is none of them were, please don't eat me.
There, sweetheart. Daddy will get you a new Tweety.
Like hell, Daddy will.
I don't want another Tweety. I don't want another anything. I just want Buck back.
Now look,
no, I never!
So we find out that Tweety's missing, and Marcy picks up a feather. So can you believe that, you know, Peg's mom ate the bird?
I like to think that Peg's mom is one of those people. Well, did you guys ever see Strangers with Candy?
No, tell us.
Okay, actually, if you're a fan of Married with Children, you'll need to watch Strangers with Candy as well. It was a series from 1999-2000, ran on Comedy Central for 3 seasons, and it was about Jerry Blank, played by Amy Sedaris. She was she dropped out of high school at 14 and went off, became like a drug addict, hooker, general criminal. But then when she was released from jail for the last time, she decided to reform herself and pick up where she left off. So basically, she was a 46-year-old ex-hooker going to high school. And it was brilliant. It was irreverent. It was a lot dirtier than Married with Children ever had a chance to be, of course. But yeah. but it was just wonderful, though.
I mean, I have to say the thing about Tweety doing a Marlon Brando impression, and he only knew 150 words, and none of them were "please don't eat me."
Yep. But the thing about Strangers with Candy though is that Jerry Blank, the heroine's father, he was played by a famous old vaudeville person, just like Kathleen Freeman had been. And his shtick was that whenever you saw him, he was stock still, not moving, not talking or anything. But apparently between the scenes, he was really quick and like moving around like the Flash. He was very quick and very eloquent and stuff. And I think Peg's mom was the same way, because I was thinking, how could she catch a flying bird? She doesn't seem very nimble, to say the least, but when she rolls over, she shakes the house. So she must have been like Jerry Blank's dad. Yeah,
well, Al says that she can unhinge her jaw like an anaconda.
Yeah, exactly.
Man,
yeah.
Wouldn't that be something to see?
Yeah. Well, how does a snake with no hands catch a running groundhog or something? They're fast. They're really fast when they want to be.
Al, I've got another idea.
Forget about it, Marcy. There's no pet in the world wouldn't fit in that woman's mouth. She can unhinge her jaw like an anaconda.
Kelly's problem is that she needs closure to reconcile herself to the fact that Buck is really gone. She needs to communicate with him.
But he's dead.
He may have crossed over to the other side, but he's not out of reach.
So Marcy recommends that Kelly needs some closure to reconcile herself, and she recommends a seance.
I thought that was a little weird. I mean, Marcy is usually pretty level-headed. I was kind of surprised that she went into the supernatural like that.
To me, like, and this is where Married Children got irreverent. They were like, wait a minute. Well, we're going to do a seance, and we're going to have it headed up by a priest, a Roman Catholic priest. So it's those two things, our audience out there, they actually don't go together. A Catholic priest would never do a seance. And in comes a very famous character from Saturday Night Live, Father Guido Sarducci, played for by Don Novello.
Yay.
Come on, Marcy, let's get this doggy seance on the road.
Father, we're ready.
Well, the house is a blast except for that big, fat, ugly she-demon up there.
Sarducci, can we talk to Buck now?
Soon, my child, with the diary in the top drawer.
Are you clairvoyant?
No, I was just going through your things. Let us all join hands.
Al, you're not joining hands.
What's the matter, Mr. Bundy? You don't believe in the afterlife?
No, it's not that, Father. It's just I don't want to hold my wife's hand.
Come on now, calm down. It is not easy to contact a dead dog. Fortunately, I have my dead dog whistle with me. Won't be long now. Let me go try something else. I got this idea. How about everybody concentrate? Okay, concentrate yourselves.
Um,
Buck Bundy, Buck Bundy.
Yeah, I know. But in bed, I hardly have to do anything.
Silence.
No, hardly. She's quite the screamer.
He wasn't talking about that.
Actually, I was. We're gathered here tonight to contact a friend. A departed friend who still carries the heartstrings for his grieving companion, the blonde chick.
Kelly.
Kelly.
So you want to tell us a little bit about Don, Carolyn?
Yeah, Don Novello is a, he's a groundbreaking writer. He started off as a writer for a paper called The Iconoclast, which is really funny. And his most famous alter ego, aside from Guido Sarducci, oh, he was a writer for Saturday Night Live, too, when it first started, which is how he invented Father Guido, actually, a few years before that. But his most famous, if you want to see his writing, which I recommend, you can go to the letters of Laszlo Toff. It was a guy he invented. And this is before the internet, before cell phones, before you could really verify if people were who they said they were. And his thing was writing very, very funny, challenging letters, kind of crank letters, but not so crank that they'd be tossed out, which is a very fine line. I've worked in a government office, and sometimes we do like ignore people. But some people, you want to answer, but they're a little off. And so he published volumes of these Laszlo letters, corresponding with some really interesting people, and they were just great. And one day he was in a thrift shop, came across a long robe, a man's robe, with a zebra lining. And so he put that together with a old-fashioned shovel hat, like Italian priests used to wear, and came up with Father Guido Sarducci. And, as a Catholic, actually, I always liked Father Guido. I thought he was very funny. He was never quite, he was disrespectful without being just mean about the church and about, and I loved the idea was supposed to be that he was a gossip columnist for the actual Vatican newspaper, which Luigi can probably pronounce a lot better than me. I'm not going to try.
L'Osservatore Romano.
Perfect. Yes, exactly. Yeah. And in this instance, what he did is he took off the sombrero hat. He's wearing a beretta. A beretta was a old-fashioned hat for priests. I had a friend who was ordained in 1966, and he still had his. But of course, he hadn't worn it for like 30 years. So it was pretty funny that he's wearing the beretta, and he's also using a sprinkler, which you use for sprinkling holy water on the congregation in certain holidays and ceremonies. Yeah, so Don Novello he's still around. He's still, still funny guy. And he's just, it's kind of like many of the actors and writers in Married with Children, it takes a lot of skill to be acting that strangely and to create a character like that, an over-the-top character like that, that is still loved. You know, in this case, it was about 20 years after his SNL gigs. And now it's like 45 years and people still remember him. So that's Father Guido. And a lot of his old stuff is on YouTube. And I think my favorite one is when he complains about, because he's playing in Italian. I mean, he's an Italian-American in real life, but he's playing in Italian and he complains. One of the big things in parochial school when I was a little kid, like first or second grade, was the canonization of Elizabeth Ann Seton. She was a widow. And what nowadays you call a social worker. She helped the poor and everything a great deal, and sailors and stuff, helped them in homes, and was a great, started all kinds of charities and stuff. And she started the Sisters of Charity in Lower Manhattan. And she was the first American-born saint to be canonized. There was plenty of saints from South America and all that, but she was, and it was a huge story. And I remember, I wasn't allowed to see Saturday Night Live. I was up too late, but I did see it a couple years later when it was in reruns and I was old enough to be able to stay up that late. I remember when Father Guido was complaining how about this American lady, she had about three miracles to her name and she was able to become a saint. And meanwhile, the Italians, they had to have like 30, 40, 50 miracles. Because it was so many Italian saints. Yeah, if you can find it on YouTube, it's brilliant.
Okay.
You know what's funny is I was just looking up Don Novello, you know, just looking on his Wikipedia page. He's only, I guess it's because the character he's playing and the way he's dressed, but I would have guessed he was a lot older than what he was. He's only 3 years older than Ed O'Neill. He's currently 78. Ed O'Neill's 75. Would you guess in this scene that those two guys are almost the same age?
Nope. But there was a difference though. In Saturday Night Live, Father Sarducci was always smoking. They would not let him do it on TV, I guess.
Yeah,
just like Peg, you had to kick smoking for network standards.
Yeah. I thought he was hilarious in the scene. This is my favorite. I mean, this next probably about 5 minute stretch here is my favorite stretch in the whole episode. I thought he was hilarious. Luigi, what did you think? I mean, you're Italian heritage, and you know, what did you think of Father Sarducci? I thought he was hilarious.
For me, it's like I love humor where it's irreverent. Like I'm equal opportunity. You know, like, I mean, I think sometimes people get offended by certain type of ethnic or even religious humor. But, you know, for myself, I was actually an altar boy when I was a kid. Carolyn, you might appreciate this. I remember when I was in elementary school, you would have this thing once a week called the Benediction of the Blessed Sacrament. So what it is the Rosary Altar Society, you know, so it's a group of old women would come in, and the priest who used to do it, there was one priest in particular, a pastor, who was like actually a fairly young person at the time, but he really loved like old school, almost like a pre-Vatican II ritual.
A lot of younger priests do. The older priests have had enough of it.
Yeah. So, you know, we would actually go down, like, I remember like how you would do it is you would come out and you would kneel in front of the altar and you'd put the host in this thing called a monstrance, and you'd be kneeling, and it's like one altar boy would actually have incense and the other one would have water, and he loved to do the thing in Latin. And for myself, like, I actually learned a lot of Latin because like we would be chanting these prayers in Latin, and I know the prayers in Italian and they're very similar, so like I learned how to do them. But, you know, having like this memory of certain things, and let me tell you, like some of the best jokes I ever heard came from priests. So you know what I'm saying? It's like there's this, and you know, I have to give Michael Moyet credit on this episode because, you know, it's a balance between like, you know, in, you would say like the sacred and the profane, right? It's,
yes,
like, you know, you,
yes,
you have this dichotomy of this image of a priest, and usually like you think of a priest, it's like someone who's holy, you know, and trying to show you how to do things the right way. But then it's like you turn around and like he's smoking a cigarette, drinking a beer, and like and cracking jokes, you know. But thing is, there are people who do that. So I find that to me is like really the dichotomy. Again, it's like a Catholic priest doing a seance, right? I mean, two things that don't go together, but that's what you're laughing at.
They did not.
You know, but it's funny, and that's what it is. And, you know, I think that at the end of the day, Michael Moyet put it very well in one of his retrospectives that he has on, you could find on YouTube. It's like, he said, you could forget about him. You could forget about Ron. I mean, you could forget about everything. It's just, but, you know, I think what he said was what he really wants in life, like, you know, like in terms of like his own life and his work. It's like, if I just made you laugh, you know, I did my job.
Aww.
You know? And, you know, and that's what you have with this. I mean, the thing is, you know, sometimes humor doesn't really hit for everyone. Again, all of us have different senses of humor. Like, for example, you know, I would always rag on Alex about the toilet jokes, right? You know, I love the Ferguson, and, you know, him and Jerry weren't really big fans of it. Some of this humor, like, you know, is going to make people howl, and other people might just be maybe slightly uncomfortable about it, right? Maybe if you're a religious person watching Married with Children, although I don't think those two things would go together. maybe you might get offended by it, but, you know, it's like, hey, like, they're very much equal opportunity. I'm going to make fun of everyone. I mean, we had a Jewish joke, we had an Italian joke, you have a Catholic joke, you know.
Exactly. Yep. Exactly. Yeah. Well, my next question was, I don't think so, but there's been a couple of hints that the Bundys are Christian. but they certainly do not go to church. All they do, they celebrate Christmas. they celebrate Christmas. Actually, didn't Kelly say once that they were banned from church?
Yeah, there was that. I mean, I believe that they would be Protestants.
Yeah.
Because they're in one of the early episodes, they talk about the Reverend Felcher. And that's actually a callback to All in the Family.
Oh, okay.
They're definitely not, I don't believe them to be Catholic, but because when you talk about a reverend, but I guess Marcy sort of recommended it. Now, what you do have, because remember when Father Guido comes in, he talks about the ugly she-demon upstairs, right? And he's is blessing the house. In a Catholic tradition, technically he would be performing the rite of exorcism.
Oh, that makes sense. Yeah, because you wouldn't need that for a séance,
right? So, in other words, he's doing the exorcism of the mother-in-law upstairs, and then he comes downstairs for the séance. Whereas technically he's conjuring spirits, which is the opposite, right? I mean,
you
see the dichotomy there.
I do. Yeah. Well, I mean, that's married with children for you, though. Just taking a bunch of whatever's funny at the moment. And someone sprinkling, even if you're Catholic, non-Catholic, someone like sprinkling holy water around is kind of a, because of a dead dog and a weird mother-in-law upstairs. That's pretty funny.
Right. And he's got his dead dog whistle, too.
That's right. But before we leave this, there's one quick thing. Do you remember in Deadpool when there was this huge pileup of unprepared middle-aged football guys, and Bub was refereeing. As he walked away, he crossed himself, and I was wondering.
Oh yeah, sure did.
Yeah, he did. And now I think it was a Faustino thing rather than a Bud Bundy thing. It was just funny. Yeah, but that's another thing I thought. But now you're right. They did say Reverend, so I don't think they're Catholic. Yeah.
Buck, hear me, Buck. Fill me up with thy spirit. My body is your vessel. Fill me up, Buck. Fill me up.
Am I the only one getting turned on here?
What is it, Father? What do you feel?
Great fear. I think Buck's in trouble.
I find it funny now, Father Guido is trying to conjure up the spirit of Buck, and he says, my body is your vessel. Fill me up, Buck. Fill me up. And Peg gets horny.
Yes. That was...
I really love
that. I mean, it strikes her at the worst possible times and places.
Yep.
And she's so consistent, And Al didn't even want to hold her hand, and now he has to deal with her, probably falling all over him.
Yeah, I cracked up whenever he says, it's not that, I just don't want to hold my wife's hand.
Those are like Henny Youngman, like those type of jokes, right?
Yep.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
We cut back to heaven.
Buck Bundy, I understand you have waived your right to an attorney.
After you ate him.
Strike that from the record. Thomas shall now read aloud from the Book of Life.
Let's see. Total number of cats chased up trees, 15.
It was harmless fun. It's not like anyone got hurt.
Total number of cats chased under the wheels of Mack trucks, 197.
I'm truly sorry about that. I was a young pup, and I did it to impress the bitches.
And finally, total number of cats eaten this morning in heaven's waiting room, 3.
Well, dog.
I don't have to be an eagle. I'll settle for a finch with webos like an eagle.
This court will recess for 1 hour while I contemplate the appropriate sentence in my litter box.
Well, this certainly sucks.
And we find out that Buck has waived his right to his attorney because he was eaten by the cat.
Yep.
So I guess it would be a mouse then, right? I guess it would be eaten by the cat.
a really big mouse, but sure, yeah.
So Thomas now is reading aloud from the Book of Life. Now, the Book of Life in Christianity and Judaism is the book in which God records the names of every person who is destined for heaven or the world to come. According to the Talmud, it is open on Rosh Hashanah, as is its counterpart for the wicked, the Book of the Dead. For this reason, extra mention is made for the Book of Life during Amidah recitations during the Days of Awe, the 10 days between Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year, and Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the two high holy days, particularly in the prayer, I'm going to butcher this, Unitana Takef. And Annabelle also points out that there is a 2014 animated movie called The Book of Life with Christina Applegate about a young man who is torn between fulfilling the expectations of his family and following his heart, embarking on an adventure that spans three fantastic worlds where he must face his greatest fears. So Thomas tells us about all of Buck's sins. So 15 cats chased up trees, 197 cats underneath the wheels of a Mack truck, and three cats eaten in the waiting room this morning.
That's right. Now we know that Buck can be like very, you know, he can be like pretty mean when he wants to be, but I don't know if we got this, did we have hints of this huge like anti-cat thing before?
I don't think much so, but you could counter that with saying, well, he pretty much has to eat cats like that because we know the Bundys don't feed him.
Oh, you're right. You're right. You know what I mean? Yeah.
So he either has to do that or he wouldn't survive.
That's true. Yeah.
Now, you know, there's this line that got lost, I think, because of the laugh track or the laughter from the audience. So, like, you know, the cat says, you know, well, dog, you know, it's like, well, I don't have to be an eagle. I'll settle for a finch with huevos like an eagle. That's a little Spanish for you.
I did rewind it and get that one. I was like, oh, huevos. Oh, it's a ball stroke. Yeah. You know, I don't think most women pick up on ball strokes as fast as guys do. No.
Yep. So when we have this, when the cat disappears and says that he's contemplating his sentence and Buck says, well, this certainly sucks. That is the last frame that we get of Buck the dog.
Oh, right.
It's a sad moment, man. Last time we see
him
on screen.
Yep.
It is, yeah. Yeah. I mean the special effects up in heaven were pretty terrible, but at least we had Ben Stein, we had the cat judge was pretty, his accent was pretty funny. You know, he could have used a little more training. He wasn't like concentrating the way he should have, but you know, it's a cat. But I love that voice. The cat judge is supposed to be like one of those Southern style, like tough hanging judges.
So we cut back down to the Bundy living room where the seance is still going on.
Be one with me, O spirit. Join with me, Buck. Join with me.
Now look here, Latoya. It's been over an hour. Get to the part where Buck is fine and Kelly's happy.
You want me to lie? What do you take me for?
A lot less than you're taking me for. Now go ahead.
Now, Al refers to Father Guido as Latoya.
I didn't quite. I know who he meant by Latoya, but I'm not sure why he referred to Sarducci as Latoya.
Yeah, I missed that connection too. I was like,
so they're referring to Latoya Jackson, who's an American singer, songwriter, actress, businesswoman, and television personality, the fifth and middle child of the Jackson family. Latoya Jackson first gained recognition on the family's variety television series, The Jacksons, on CBS between 1976 and 1977. Thereafter, she saw success as a solo recording artist under multiple record labels in the 1980s and 1990s, where she released 9 studio albums over the course of 15 years. Her most successful releases in the United States were her self-titled debut album and the 1984 single Heart Don't Lie. One of Jackson's songs was Just Say No from her fifth album, was composed for U.S. First Lady Nancy Reagan and the Reagan administration's anti-drug campaign. So, if I remember correctly, LaToya Jackson during this time period, she was really into like, she wasn't like, what's her name, Dionne Warwick with the Psychic Friends Network, but she was like, she had one of those, she was like into spirituality and all that. I think like she was into this kind of stuff, and that was their joke on LaToya Jackson. That's the connection between the two.
Okay. All right, that makes sense.
Okay, that makes sense. Yeah, I wasn't really paying attention back then to her, so.
Okay, I will again attempt to break through. I broke through.
Buck?
Yes, it's me, Buck.
Daddy. Daddy, Buck's Italian. The afterlife is in Italy.
You know, Al has to slap Father Guido to get him to, you know, finish the seance.
Yeah.
I broke through.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he says, "Hey, Buck, yes, it's a me, Buck." And Kelly says that Buck's Italian. Yeah, that's pretty much an Italian-American sound. And you would hope that the afterlife is in Italy. What do you think?
Oh, definitely heaven is in Italy. Yes.
Oh, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Oh, totally. Yeah.
A little Dean Martin playing in the background, you know.
Yeah.
Some pasta.
The food never. Yep. As long as you don't need, and the thing is, in heaven, nothing ever breaks down, so you don't have to rely. You don't have to worry about the government messing up repairs and things like that. So.
Oh God.
Sorry for the Italian government dig. Yep. Sorry. Who's the prime minister today? I forget.
Oh yeah. Like there's a new one every week. That's the exactly.
Yep.
Is it Emmanuel Macron or is that France? I'm trying to remember.
Yeah, no, Macron is France.
Macron is France. I'm trying to remember Italian.
I think I was thinking it's Mario Draghi, but isn't he like the EC head or something? I don't know.
Well, the thing is, you know, at the day we're recording this, by the time it's broadcast, it may very well be somebody else.
That's true. It doesn't matter. Yeah.
I miss you, Buck.
Oh, I miss you too, Kelly. But I think it's the time for both of us to move on. Go forth, my child, and get yourself another dog. A cheap dog. And Kelly, share yourself with others like you have shared yourself with me, Buck.
I'll do that. I will share myself with others.
If she shared herself anymore, she'd be traded on the New York Stock Exchange.
So, you know, so Father Guido, trying to channel Buck, tells Kelly that it's time for her to go on and get another dog. Al's not happy with that.
Nope, a cheap dog.
That's right. And and Kelly should share herself with others like you've shared yourself with Buck. And Buck and Bud's got a great line.
Yes.
Yeah. So Father Guido tries to get a cheap feel out of this, right?
Now, before we say goodbye, is there anything I can do for you?
Well, Buck would like to have a little hug.
No, of course.
And maybe a little kiss.
Okay.
You know, Buck would really like to have his tummy rubbed.
Would Buck like to have a little shoe up his blowhole?
The spirit has departed.
Yeah. Yeah. Al had to smack him to get him to stop creeping Kelly here.
I think my favorite line of that whole thing is, you know, would Buck like to have a little shoe up his blowhole?
Yeah, that was pretty good. Yeah. That was a good one. Yeah. Even Kelly was starting to realize something was a little off there.
Would you like to give Buck a little kiss? And she kind of looked like, okay.
Let's give Buck a belly rub. That was great. But I do have to say, though, a few lines before that, he actually was giving her really halfway decent advice.
about moving, about how you know, Buck was happy now, and she had made him so happy, and that she had to move. They were both ready to move on, and you know, he was actually helping her. But the first time in the episode, anyone actually helped Kelly.
Yeah.
Hey, wait, while you're still out there, I used to have a pet goldfish named Winky.
Not on my dime, you didn't, buddy.
So, you know, Jefferson points out that, you know, he wants to conjure up the spirit of a pet goldfish named Winky. Now, you know, Annabelle has found this out that, you know, and I haven't really paid attention, but really Annabelle has really zoned in on this. There have been multiple pets named Winky in Married with Children. So Marcy had a pet named Winkums in season 6, episode 14. There was a parrot named Winky in season 4, episode 23. That's when the Bundys have a yard sale. There was also a family dog named Winky referenced in season 4, episode 20. And there was another dog referenced named Winky in season 8, episode 18. So it must have been some kind of in-joke.
Annabelle never ceases to amaze me, man. She's like a walking encyclopedia of knowledge. It's just like the connections that she can make from episode to episode, and, you know, like one little line and connect this back to season 4 and season 3, season 8. You know what I mean? She's truly incredible.
She really is. She notices patterns that no one else does.
Yep.
That's great. Yeah. But probably somebody had like a dog, like a puppy or something called Winky, and they teased him about it. They kept on teasing him for 11 years.
Yep.
So that's what writers, that kind of stuff goes on in writers' rooms from what I hear. Mm-hmm. But Al's response to Jefferson's request is one of my favorite lines too.
Yeah. Not on my dime. You don't.
Yeah. Yes. That's another useful line for life. Not on my dime. Yep. You didn't.
Hey, wait a minute, you guys. Now, you heard what Buck said. He wants me to get another dog.
But, Pumpkin, it's after 9 o'clock. Daddy's broke. There's no way in the world we can find another...
Hey, wait a minute. What's that?
Look, it's a puppy. Where did it come from?
It's a sign. A sign from Buck.
That's ridiculous.
It's entirely possible.
Oh, look how cute he is.
Wait a minute. I'm not an eagle. I'm a dog.
Al says, you know, it's past 8 o'clock. Where am I going to get another dog? And I'm broke. And then all of a sudden, you know, this is very atypical for Married with Children. It's like we almost had... It's like this, I mean, I don't know what you call it. It's almost like a miracle from heaven. All of a sudden, this dog in a basket magically appears.
Yeah. And it's also one of the few times, really, if you think about it, where the episode ends with a happy ending, really. I mean, I guess you could say it's happy for everyone except for Buck. Buck's not happy because he gets reincarnated with the Bundys. But for most people in the episode, it's a happy ending. They name the new dog Lucky, but they know that it's Buck, you know. And it's like most episodes don't get tied up in a nice little bow. They usually end with, you know, like Al jumping out of an airplane or something crazy like that, you know.
for such an over the top show, you know, it really leaves reality. I mean, physical reality. Whenever it does go somewhere, it's almost always a dream or a story that someone's telling someone else, like Peggy and the Pirates, and they very rarely go into like just like the unbelievable realm.
Yeah,
but this time it didn't. I think it worked, although it was pretty funny. You could tell this wasn't the cast of Star Trek because they're all having trouble looking at the special effect at the same time.
Yeah.
But you know, that must be really hard. But still.
And you know, the other thing I'll say is like now it's like it's funny. It's like, oh wait a minute, you know, like Buck realizes that he's been reincarnated. And it's almost like, you know, the worst thing that could possibly happen is for him to just return where he came from.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Yeah, that's literally the worst possible punishment they could have gave him. Mm-hmm. That's how it worked out.
Well, that cat judge really knew what he was doing.
What should we name him?
I know. Let's call him Lucky.
Lucky Bundy.
Gee, I was saving that name for my tombstone.
Uh-oh. Those voices sound oddly familiar. If I could just get these newborn eyes to focus.
Eyes, your babies.
No!
I want to take a pause here about Lucky the dog. Now, you know, we're going to now start to see Lucky the dog in place of Buck going forward. And I think, you know, for me, it's like this dog of all dogs. I mean, you know, Buck,
right.
Buck worked as a real mutt for the Bundys. But it's like this is not the kind of dog I would expect the Bundys to have. Right.
Exactly.
No.
And that's like to me, Buck. I know this is going to sound funny, but Buck was kind of an ugly dog. So he fit perfectly with the Bundys. To me, Lucky, I mean, even as a kid, I was like, wow, Lucky is really cute. You know, and the audience's reaction was, aww. You know what I mean? Like, to me, Lucky was always too cute to be a member of the Bundy family. You know, I mean, he's too cute. Like, Lucky is the type of dog that you would almost expect like a rich family to have. You know what I mean? He looks too rich for the Bundys.
Yeah, and the funny thing was, as far as I know, Steve and Rick, he did get Buck from a shelter. I'm going to go into that a little more later, you know, about solutions to you know, Al's problem of not being able to get a free dog. Anyway. Yeah, but as far as I can tell, Blucky is like a purebred Cocker Spaniel, just like, you know, and a purebred Briard looks, especially if his ears aren't artificially put up, looks pretty muddy. But this, you're right. He look expensive and too cute.
Yeah. I mean, it's just like, I don't know. It just, he never really fit. I mean, Lucky certainly has a couple of episodes that are pretty good in season 10 and 11. And we'll get to those when we get to them. But I don't know. I always thought Lucky was an odd fit.
Yeah. I mean, he was pretty, you know, Steve and Rick did a good job training him to do tricks and stuff, but just lying around and just being able to like give out thoughts in the family. I don't think he was, you know, really good at that.
Yep.
And you know, and that to me was really like the thing that really stuck out. I'm like, really, the Bundys have this dog of all dogs?
Yeah.
You know, and starting the next episode, we're going to have new opening credits to reflect the fact that we have Lucky the dog. Mm-hmm. So, you know, this is the last episode where we have Buck doing the opening sequence. So, So now we have this transition again. We're getting closer and closer to the end. Right, Chris and Carolyn? So,
yep.
So anyway, so just Al makes the comment that, you know, he was saving, they name him Lucky Bundy, and Al is disappointed because he was saving that name for his tombstone.
Oh, boy.
End credits, and there's this great little dedication to Buck the dog. Which says, dedicated to Buck the dog, who with this episode begins a well-earned retirement and hopefully a nice gig at stud. We'll miss you, buddy. Lift a leg, the producers.
Yeah, that was really sweet. I think that was really nice.
It was, yeah. They like to do that. They did it a couple times and it's your move, too. Mm-hmm. You know, the same set of producers. Although I'm afraid that Buck was neutered, but other than that, it was very sweet.
You know, as we mentioned at the beginning, so Buck the dog died on May 28th, 1996, in Aiken, California, at the age of 13 and a half. He was old.
Mm-hmm.
His body was cremated, and his ashes were given to his trainer, Stephen Ritt.
All I can say is that I just had the predecessor to the two dogs that I'm dog-sitting right now was a rescue dog named Bella. Bella, and a couple of years before that, Lester. And all I can say is that you know when a dog is ready to go. You know when a dog has lived a good life, and they're ready to move on. You know, life is not worth it anymore, and you give them the last gift. And I'm can only imagine how many times Stephen Ritt has had to do that. But I just appreciate him giving us one of the, I think seriously, one of the great animal actors.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he had whole lines of dialogue. He would have plots where he was a protagonist. And so I think that Buck added so much when I was children.
Yeah, he really did. And it's like, you don't really, until you really see the, until you, I guess the old saying, you don't know what you have until you don't have it anymore. We didn't realize how perfect Buck was for the family until we make this transition. Buck really, really fit with the Bundys, you know, in appearance and the voice, you know, they had various voice actors over the course of the series. Some of them more obnoxious than others, like when they had Cheech and Chong, you know. He really fit with the Bundy family perfectly. And I was looking up his online to see, because I know I've seen him in other stuff, that particular dog.
Lucky, really?
No, not Lucky Buck. I know I've seen Buck in other things.
No, ma'am. We'll be right back to wrap up this week's review. Be sure to join their Facebook group page for all the podcast news and updates. Be sure to subscribe to them on the Apple Podcast app, and please leave a review telling them what you think of the show. To subscribe to their YouTube channel, just go to Channels and search up Married with Children Podcast. Join their Patreon and support your favorite podcast with a small monthly donation. You can email them at marriedwchildrenpodcast@gmail.com. Thanks for checking out this review.
All right, and we're back. So, Chris, how many 100-pound bags of juju beads will you be carrying for this episode?
Well, that's a good question. I do enjoy this episode. I like it quite a bit. As I mentioned, you know, in the first part of the podcast, when my family and I were watching this, we were worried that it was going to be Al was going to be the member of the family that's passed away. So, you know, we were relieved that it wasn't. But in the end, we were sad that that we were losing Buck. You know, we learned that in the very opening scene. It was sad. I think this was a good send-off to him. I think this was a great way to pay tribute to Buck the dog, who, as we know, was a member of the family for the first 9-plus seasons. And I think they did a good service for him. The episode had some really good lines. I mean, granted, the episode was corny. You know, it opens with a funeral for a dog. Al spends $1,200 for a funeral for a dog, which is crazy. But the episode was funny. I really enjoyed Father Sarducci's character. I thought he was hilarious. He was a good addition to the episode. Pretty much anything with Ben Stein in it, I like it. I thought his character was funny and corny as always. I thought the idea of how they were going to transition into getting the Bundy family a new dog was a genius idea. You know, as far as having him go to court almost in heaven, where God turns out to be a cat and he gets reincarnated as another dog with the Bundys. I thought that was brilliant. And I really liked the episode. So I am going to give it 4. And remind me, what am I doing here? 4 bags of...
400-pound bags of juju beads.
Okay, sorry. So I am going to give it 4 100-pound bags of juju beads out of 5.
That's great. All right, so Carolyn, how many 100-pound bags of juju beads will you be carrying for this episode?
Well, I think it's very rare that an episode has so much come together. Now, a send-off for a vital cast member. Amazing guest stars. There were no bad guest stars in this one. Usually there's one or two that you just go, you know, oh, that's that guy. Yeah, there was that guy. They're both very funny men using their personas in the perfect way. The family dynamics were terrific. The costumes were great. Everyone, you know, actually, most of those people look pretty good in black. So too bad they didn't get to wear black more often. However, there were a couple of things that didn't make it, you know, I'm not going to carry all 500 pounds of juju beads for this episode. It almost deserved it, except for I didn't like Bud being so callous and Al misreading Kelly at the beginning and then being nice to her later. Well, that was a little inconsistent. I didn't like people's mornings seemed to be kind of inconsistent, kind of, you know, they were mean. Sometimes they were mean to Kelly I especially didn't like when Bud and Jefferson, who were paired up a lot in this episode, I didn't like that they cracked jokes about Bud being dead. I wasn't too happy about that. So what I will do is I will take the 100-pound bag of jujubes and pour it into a 50-pound bag, and I will carry 450 pounds of jujubes for this episode.
That's great. So for myself, I will be carrying 400 pounds of jujubes, so four bags, 400-pound bags of jujubes for this episode. You know, Chris knows me as the 3.5 guy when it comes to you know my ratings with Married with Children episodes, especially in the later seasons. You know, this episode is written by Michael Moyer. I think he did a great job.
Yes.
He put a lot of things together. I think, you know, there was just some parts of it that had to maybe be a little silly or a little extra farcical. Like some of the jokes like felt like Borscht Belt. I mean, they were Borscht Belt jokes, right? It's like, well, you know, like, where am I going to find another daughter, or, you know, et cetera. But, you know, I think it was a great send off for Buck the dog. And like I said, I as a, you know, again, as a 17-year-old, I guess at the time, watching it, you know, I was like, oh my God, like, you know, Buck the dog is dead. Like, I was sad. You know, because I feel like Buck is just as much as part of the family as any one of, you know, the human characters in that house. And, you know, and he's always, and Buck always had, you know, the one-liners and, you know, his own personality. I mean, he banged up all the bitches in the neighborhood, you know, in his own words. So, you know, it's bittersweet, but, you know, obviously you understand mm-hmm. the fact that, you know, he's a 12-and-a-half-year-old dog. I mean, if you multiply by 7 in dog years, it's like, what is he, like 90, like 80, 84, I guess?
84, yeah. Like almost 90, yeah, 84 and yeah. a half, yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, I can understand that, you know, that's what happened to Buck. So I just think that, you know, it was slightly better than, like, in an average, like, late series episode. So I gave it 4. Not bad. I mean, not bad for our first
episode. No.
Not bad for Team Chris and Luigi's with our guest, with guest co-host Carolyn's first episode of season 10. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was going to say, you know, Chris, can you believe it? We're already in season 10, huh?
Time flies, man. It really does.
And I'm looking at the list of episodes, and it was like a real roller coaster, you know, of some of my favorites and some of my, oh my, I don't remember that at all.
Yeah, you know, and I'm sure, you know, Annabelle, who was the lead on, you know, the season opener, you know, spoke about season 10. And, you know, we also had the season 9 wrap-up show where we talk about, you know, what to expect in season 10. And, you know, my perspective on it is, you know, when you look at the list, you know, Chris, I have the list in front of me. It's like, oh, like, you know, we say it's like, oh, season 10 and season 11, you know, the show ran out of gas. And, you know, yeah. There's usually not some great show, you know, great episodes. But, you know, we start looking at this. It's like, wow, like, there's actually some really great work here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, we got Al the Reverend coming up. We've got the Terry Bradshaw episode coming up, which is one of my personal favorites. So we got for some pretty good ones coming up.
Yeah, we have Pat Morita, you know, coming up, and Carolyn, we hope that you join us for that one again.
Oh yeah, that's a good episode. That's a really good episode.
Yeah, you know, so I mean, like, we really do have a lot of things to look forward to in season 10, and you know, as we've said since Alex has been gone, we're just continuing the journey.
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Unlike Buck, our journey continues for a while longer.
So, Carolyn, you know, just from your perspective, I guess just before we sign off, so, you know, so how has this journey been for yourself being on a podcast? I mean, I'll tell you, you know, a little over a year ago, you know, neither Chris nor myself thought we would ever be, you know, hosting a podcast, you know, other than maybe potentially just being on as a guest. So, I mean, it's really been one hell of a journey for us. But, like, well, for yourself, I mean, this is what, your maybe third or fourth time on this podcast?
I think it's my third, yes, at least, yeah. Yeah, well, it's it's not what I expected either, really. It's it gets easier each time, which is always nice, thing to happen. I'm getting used to listening to myself, which takes a while.
Yep.
Yeah, and as time goes on, I just realized that I can relax a lot more. You know, it becomes I'm not saying it becomes easier to come up with stuff, but once you get into the groove, it's easier to get into the groove now and cast yourself back to who you were when you were watching Married with Children and what it meant to you.
Yeah.
Which is, even if it wasn't very much sometimes, you know?
Yeah. You know, and what I'll say is, you know, all of us experience the shows different ways, you know, and I think we've all talked about our stories, but you know, there's, I think really two elements to the show, and that's sort of like my two cents as we begin season 10. It's, you know, it is for us a work of nostalgia because, you know, we sort of remember, you know, who we were when the first time we saw this, the first time we got to enjoy it. And it's still, you know, entertainment for us all these years later.
Yeah.
You know, 26 years later, here we are, you know, talking about something we, you know, we saw back then and we still laugh at it. You know, almost, and it's fresh.
Yes.
A lot of times when you see it, like, you know, you sort of, it's like, I describe like people who watch The Honeymooners, right? So, you know, The Honeymooners, what most people know as The Honeymooners was 39 episodes. 39 half-hour episodes.
Wow.
And there are people who watch it every single day. I mean, if you're in the New York area, it's on Channel 11 at 11 p.m. every night. Uh-huh. And, you know, you pretty much in a month and a half, you cycle through the entire thing. And they've been playing it for over 50 years. It's been playing. And there are people who, like, will just tune in every night. And it's like, you know, they've watched, you know, Ed Norton and Ralph Crandom dancing in that kitchen, you know. And like I said, now, mind you, there are like, there's this whole series of Honeymooners sketches called the Lost Episodes. So if we look at, like, if you look at the totality of Honeymooners sketches, there's about like 200 of them. And, you know, there's a DVD collection, which I actually own, which goes through them. But most people remember the classic 39. And there they are, like every night. I mean, you've been watching this for 50 years and you're still laughing at the same thing. And you know the line and you know the music and you know the cue. But, like, you know, there's something about sitting in front of a television, putting it on, and it's comfortable. Yeah. And it, you know, it feels good. It's like going home to your mother's, you know, typical dish. It might be, you know, roast beef or meatloaf or, you know, something. And it's like, and just feeling comfort in it. And for the Married with Children fan, here we are. It's like, it's the same exact thing. We just feel comfortable. Mm-hmm. And it's funny. And it puts a smile on our face. And that's why we do it. And that's why we love it.
You know, Luigi, you hit the nail right on the head with everything you just said. In fact, I was telling, you know, I had dinner with Stephen Scott this last weekend, and I was telling him, yeah, I had a lot of fun. He took me to a nice Mexican restaurant there in Tulsa. And I was telling him, I was like, you know, I picture myself probably 30 years from now. I'll be in my mid to late 60s by then. And I picture myself still binge watching Married with Children once or twice a year and listening to these old podcast episodes and looking back and saying, man, I can't believe I was a part of that. You know what I mean? It's like even just a small part. I mean, we do once you include by the time we join, you know, the other groups and stuff, I guess we do about 10 episodes a season for the last four seasons of the show, basically, or three seasons of the show, basically. Four seasons. Yeah, 8, 9, 10, 11. It's like I was a part of that, even albeit a small part, but it's kind of cool, and it's something that, you know, I'll hold special to my heart, you know. Probably 30 years from now when I'm in my 60s, I'll be introducing this show to my grandchildren probably and telling them how I grew up watching it and how, hey, you know, I got an opportunity to be a part of the podcast, you know, and it's been a lot of fun. And I know it'll be a lot of fun looking back 30 years from now.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, I mean, what I'll say about that comment you just made is I'm sure that, you know, you won't introduce it to your grandchildren at the age that you started watching the show.
Probably not. Yeah, I've said it before. I don't know why I was allowed to watch this when I was watching it. Although by the time we get 30 years from now, you know, I don't know. Who knows? I'll be married with children, might be banned by then. But the good thing is that I have my DVD set, so they can't take that away from me, right?
Well, you know, I actually, Chris, great thing about DVD set is that sometimes in streaming they censor episodes or move them around, and sometimes for good reason.
Yeah.
But it's nice to have like an adult. Okay, so they took away the theme song, but other than that, you know, it's nice to have like a nice like unadulterated pure copies.
Yeah, sure, definitely.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so thanks for listening again to this week's episode of the Married with Children podcast. Next week, Team Steven and Tyler will be reviewing Reverend Al. Al and his men's group, No Ma'am, decide to form their own church in order to avoid paying beer tax. When Marcy and her women's group, Fang, expose Al's plan to the public, No Ma'am surprisingly receives sympathy and donations from thousands of long-suffering married men in America, which makes it possible for them to open their church. Al becomes a televangelist and preaches the No Ma'am way of life. So I'm really looking forward to that. And Carolyn, thanks again. It's really a treat whenever we have you on.
Oh, thank you.
You really add a lot to the, you know, podcast and the discussion. It's always great to have a woman's perspective on this. So we really appreciate it. And we look forward to having you on again real soon.
Yeah, it's always a pleasure, Carolyn. You're a great super fan. It's always nice talking to you.
Oh, thank you, guys. And just another thing that bugged me about this episode is that, I mean, right now I'm upstate dog sitting two rescue dogs. They come from the Mid-Hudson Valley shelter. They're both fine, they're healthy, and they were free. So if you want like a free, genetically interesting dog... Because they're both mixed breeds, but they're both delightful. I don't know why they wouldn't go that way, or why someone wouldn't bring it up, especially Marcy. You think Marcy would be more into animal rights and would bring up, you know, why don't you guys go to a shelter? But I think the rebuttal to that would have been that even, except for the cheapest, most careless shelters, they do a home visit. So the Bundys would not have passed a home visit. So I guess that's the answer. But I do wish I'd been brought up. And if you're looking for a dog, you know, think adoption first, think shelter first. Thanks. Just wanted to let people know that.
So tune in again next week. Same Bundy time, same Bundy channel.